This is our last class, and I wanted to take this opportunity to reflect on the agenda of the course and to discuss it with you. So I see two main themes in this course, a foreground theme and a background theme. The foreground theme is the character, the consequence, and the fate of the now dominant practice of legal analysis, which I have most often labeled here as the method of reasoned elaboration. The understanding of law in the language of ascribed purpose, represented in the vocabulary of impersonal policy and principle. So I have tried to understand the distinctive character of this style of legal analysis. Its consequences, its limitations, and what could and should succeed it in the history of legal thought. A basic premise of the discussion is that there is no such thing as legal reason. There are historically located and distinctive styles of a legal analysis. We cannot legitimately ask what legal reasoning is. It has no essence. We can only ask, in what state have we received it? And what should we turn it into? And for what purpose? That has been the foreground theme of the course. The background theme of the course has been our attitude to the institutional and ideological settlement in society, which in some sense this dominant practice of legal analysis serves. The last major episode of institutional and ideological refoundation in the rich North Atlantic world occurred some 70 years ago. It was the social democratic settlement of the mid-20th century, which in the United States goes under the name of the New Deal, and in Europe under the name of social democracy, the regulated market economy, or the social market economy. An underlying thesis of many of my arguments has been that none of the fundamental problems of the contemporary societies can be adequately solved or even addressed within the limits of this institutional and ideological settlement. A style of legal analysis that takes it for granted, therefore, exacts from us an unacceptable price. Those are the two main themes of the course. Now, this argument addressing these two themes, the foreground theme and the background theme, bears on three large sets of questions, which have not been the primary object of the arguments of the course, even though they are implied by our discussions. So first they bear on ideas about the alternatives, and especially the institutional alternatives, the alternative ways of organizing a market economy and of organizing a democracy. Now the whole world lives in a sense under a dictatorship of no alternatives, with a very restricted repertory of live options for the institutional organization of different areas of social life. So a premise of the arguments in the courts has been that if we are to recover the imagination of alternatives, we cannot recover it from the top down by inference from abstractions like socialism, but rather from the bottom up, from the inside out, by deepening the institutional variations that already exist in the life of the contemporary societies. The second set of ideas that this argument bears on are ideas about how we understand structural change, structural discontinuity, and structural alternatives in history. And by structural, I mean in particular those alternatives, those ideas that have to do with institutional alternatives, with the institutional forms of economic, political, and social pluralism. And the third set of ideas implied by these arguments are ideas about the ideal, about what we want. If what we want is simply something more than the humanization or the spiritualization of the existing order, of the order inaugurated by the last major institutional and ideological settlement. So there's something artificial and forced and limited about the character of this argument, which is that it deals with these two themes that I've described, the foreground theme and the background theme, and fails to pursue the larger context, and in particular in these three sets of areas of ideas. Now, such a procedure is imposed on me by the character of the university system. So we have had 11 classes to discuss the world and the fate of legal thought. And it's unnatural, because the true character of thought is a storm that carries us where we would not want to go, and that can have no limitations. It cannot be limited in this way. We would have to pursue thought in each of these larger directions, in each of these three larger directions that I described, and we cannot do it in this form of meeting for a couple of hours a week for 11 weeks. It requires a much more intense mobilization of thought and a much more complete commitment of time, and therefore a crucial requisite in thinking, which is patience. There's no real thought without a willingness to waste time, to pursue many false directions, many unprofitable ends, until we've pursued our perplexities to the hilt. Nothing could be more alien to the university system. And so I like want to take an opportunity to just reflect for a moment and to give you my unsolicited advice about what to do in this situation. The university is good at something. So it's mainly good at providing a training in methods, in skills. How to speak German, how to solve problems in physics, and introducing people to the established ideas in inherited bodies of knowledge. What the university, on the whole, is surprisingly bad at are ideas, thought. Ideas are very rare. Few people have ideas. On the whole, the professoriate is hostile to ideas and resentful of the experience of thinking. The characteristic trajectory of an academic career is to assimilate very early an analytic and argumentative apparatus, and then to spend the rest of one's life feeding material through this apparatus. And the notion that we could think as the dead thinkers studied by the professors think is regarded as an offense. So it's not reasonable to expect ideas from the university. It's reasonable to expect what the university is good at providing, which are these methods. And it is nonsensical to imagine that the main source of your education can be courses in school. They have a merely supplementary character, and they introduce you to the ideas and methods that are predominant in your historical circumstance. But if you want to be serious, if you want to be in possession of yourself, of your mind, and not to be the slave of your historical circumstance, you must take your education into your own hands. If along the way you find among your contemporaries and teachers and a couple of people who can inspire you, you should judge yourself extraordinarily lucky. But it's not reasonable to expect the main form of your education to come from school. It has to come from yourself. The most common defect in the education of the educated classes in contemporary societies is an inadequate familiarity with the history of philosophy and with a history of the fundamental ideas of the major thinkers in the history of humanity. But this is a problem that you can readily solve by taking things into your own hand, by studying the history of philosophy, the history of social theory, studying it in general, and then in particular seeking to understand in depth the ideas of one or two or three great thinkers. There's no better way to form your mind than to form your mind in dialogue or intention with a great mind. Not necessarily a thinker with whose ideas you sympathize. It may be a thinker whose ideas you antagonize. To select one or two thinkers and to study in depth everything he ever wrote or said, and to form your mind, not to allow the whole of your time to be occupied by the concerns, the fashions, the ephemeral fashions of the academic situation in which you find yourself. So that's the advice that I give you. In order to pursue any subject, not just this subject, in a spirit of seriousness. So that's the first set of remarks that I wanted to make now at the conclusion of the course about the two themes and the spirit that they require. Seriousness means unlimited commitment. So in this sense, the two most appealing activities in the world are politics and philosophy. If by philosophy we mean not the technical discipline of academic philosophy, but the activities of the mind at war, unresigned to the limitations of any particular branch of thought. What distinguishes these two human activities from all others is that they're not about anything in particular. They're about everything. And in addition to being about everything, they require an unlimited mobilization of our efforts. And if it is true that our most distinctive attribute is our transcendence, our inability to fit into any particular context, then these are the only two activities that are indisputably worthy of a human being. And so now I want to come to my second set of remarks about the problems with which we are left by the argument that I have attempted to develop in the course. I've mentioned them before several times, and they are the problems that I've labeled as the problem of agency, the problem of politics, and the problem of thought. So first, the problem of agency. I discussed a possible future for the practice of legal analysis. This touches on the foreground theme of the course. The dominant practice of legal analysis is the representation of law in the language of impersonal policy and principle, this idealizing and systematizing discourse about law, which is a kind of halo pinned on the institutional and ideological settlement of the mid-20th century. And from its twin bases in the United States and Germany, it is now being propagated throughout the world. I discussed in the arguments of the course reasons to resist this vision of the future of legal analysis. To reject it as the wave of the future that its proponents claim it to be. And in that argument, I also claimed that we have to draw a sharp distinction between two vocations of legal thought. A narrower vocation in the adjudicative setting, and a larger and broader vocation outside it. The larger vocation is the vocation of informing the public conversation in a democracy about the alternative institutional futures of society. There then arises the problem that I labeled the problem of agency. Concede for a moment that there is this task. The question then emerges whether there is an agent for the execution of this task. Who will do this work, this larger work, this prophetic and transformative vocation of legal thought? It seems that there is no readily available agent. Now, recognizing that fact, if it is a fact, I argued that this disparity between the claim of the task and the unavailability of the agent always occurs. The world is organized to reproduce itself. And the agents that exist are the agents that are designed for the convenience of the reproduction of the world. So the agent that is required must always be formed retrospectively after the task, not prospectively. And we have to choose among the agents that exist, each of which has to be used incongruously until a better agent can be formed. Now, the law schools, or the legal profession, may not be an ideal agent for this task. But on this view, there is no ideal agent. And the question is whether it's a usable agent or a more serviceable agent than any other agent that happens to be around and available. So one can see certain features of the legal profession that fit it for this role. In every major legal culture in the world, the lawyers are not represented or regulated as simply the advocates of particular interests, but they are also officers of the court or of the state. They have a public role. And as I observed more than once in our discussions in the course, in most countries in the world, although not in the United States, most of the people who come to law school are not intending to practice law in any narrow sense. They're seeking accession to the national elites, and their objective is to learn what the deal is in their society and what is the official discourse in which to represent the deal and to elaborate it. Similarly, one could say that the activity of this larger vocation of law, of legal thought, to recover the imagination of alternatives from the bottom up or from the ground up, rather than to infer it from ideological abstractions like socialism, has a foothold in the historical category of doctrine, of legal doctrine. So the concept of legal doctrine has certain characteristics. It's that I described in an earlier moment in the course. It is constitutive of its subject matter. It takes the subject matter as having two levels, a level of symbols and an underlying level of intention or value. It treats the agent, the jurist, as internal to the tradition, and the outcome of doctrinal dispute is having practical consequences. So in the lesser vocation of legal thought, which is legal thought in the adjudicative context, we can easily imagine a certain stretching or reinvention of the category of doctrine. And in the larger vocation of legal thought is the imagination of alternatives. The stretching has to be more extreme. But nevertheless, there is a point of departure in the historical category of doctrine. So this is the problem of agency. Now we come to the second problem, the problem of politics. The larger vocation of legal thought supposes that legal thought will be an interlocutor or a partner of transformative activity in society. But what happens if this transformative activity is not present, or present only in a very limited way? So I describe this present, our present circumstance in legal thought, which I call this period of darkness, these cycles in the history of legal thought. There are moments of foundation or refoundation in which the institutional and ideological settlement is reshaped. The last time that happened was in the mid-20th century. There are moments of normalization in which the new settlement is translated into a system of categories. And then there are these periods of darkening in which the last settlement recedes into the historical past and ceases to speak with clarity and authority. Such, I argued, is our own circumstance. So then the question, which I'm calling the question of politics, is to what extent can legal thought make up for the absence of some agitation or transformative effort in the larger society? So that we are not condemned simply to await the next moment of transformation. And the answer to that question is unclear. We don't know. So we might hope that it can make up for the absence of this movement to some extent. But it can't jump out of the historical circumstance. So the truth must be something different from these two extreme answers to the problem. One that all legal thought can do is to reflect or express the presence or absence of a transformative movement in society, or that it can supply the deficit of such a transformative movement and can stand in its place. Neither one nor the other. But what we might believe is that, as Poincaré said, chance favors the prepared mind. We can develop a set of ideas and a set of practices that can then become fertile as a transformative movement arises, and can even help to fertilize it or to provoke it. And this is more than a theoretical question. It's a question of moral immediacy for each of us, because as I remarked early in the course, if we happen to have been born in one of these long historical interludes in which there is no major refoundation, we have to ask ourselves whether we must be resigned to the fate of simply awaiting the next major shaking up, or whether we can take things somehow into our own hands. Now then comes the third enigma with which we're left by these arguments that I've tried to develop. And the third enigma is the problem that I call the problem of thought. So a major underlying focus of the argument in the course, especially with respect to the background theme, the attitude to the institutional and ideological settlement in society, is our imagination of structure, of structural alternatives and structural discontinuity in history. Now the high academic culture is hostile to the imagination of structural alternatives. The rationalizing, humanizing, and escapist tendencies in the high culture. And philosophy, which would be or should be an instrument of structural vision, is for the most part neutralized. So there are two main conceptions of philosophy in the history of philosophy. Neither of them seems acceptable to us. One conception is that philosophy is a super science in the service of self-help. So a super science is a view of the framework, of the ultimate framework of existence and of reality. That's what most of the great philosophers claim to provide. No, denying that our situation in the world is one of groundlessness, that we're unable to penetrate the ultimate framework of existence, claiming to describe it, and claiming to describe it in the service of some kind of self-help. And what is the self-help? The self-help is serenity, composure, especially composure in the face of death, of mortality. That's what most of classical philosophy is. You're going to die, but it's not so bad. Here's the framework of existence. It can, if you understand it, you can compose yourself. Now, this conception of philosophy has become unbelievable, and it has been replaced by another conception, often, which is worse than illusory, degenerate and perverse, which is philosophy is a kind of thought police. So teaching you what counts as a good argument entirely bereft of any substantive vision. But is a police which humanity has no interest in employing. So it speaks only to itself. Its activity is less dangerous than it is superfluous. And we would need a completely different conception of philosophy as the mind at war. The mind insisting on its prerogative of addressing what matters most at the limits of thought and of language, and of disrupting the orthodoxies of the university culture. So in the history of social thought, in classical social theory, in classical European social theory, there is a structural vision, for example, in Marxism. But it is a structural vision circumscribed and eviscerated, corrupted by a series of concessions to deterministic or necessitarian assumptions. And in contemporary social science, on the other hand, there's the systematic suppression of structural vision and the naturalization of social life. So legal thought requires structural vision, but can't import it from the established disciplines. It can't import it from economics or political science or sociology or philosophy as they now exist. And so how are we to solve this problem? We need all these forms of insight, but not the forms of insight that are provided by the disciplines as they are now established. So we have to raid them, we have to use them, but we can't believe in them completely in their present form. This is the problem I'm calling the problem of thought. And these three problems, the problem of agency, the problem of politics, the problem of thought, are very closely related. And somehow they all have to do with this problem, which in a sense is a moral problem and not just a cognitive problem. How can we engage without surrendering? We have to use what exists. We can't invent it from nothing. But we can't diminish ourselves. We can't lower ourselves to the level of these options that are before us. So I have recalled the two themes of the course, the foreground theme and the background theme. And these three problems in the background of agency, politics, and thought. And now I just want to make one more remark. And that has to do with with this fact that all of our engagements in all of our deep engagements in particular areas of thought seem to be entangled in a contest of large conceptions of who we are and what we should become. And certainly in these arguments that I pursued in this course, there is such a conception. It's not a conception that I invented. It's a conception that comes from the tradition from which I'm speaking. So it's the tradition from a religious standpoint of the Semitic monotheisms, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam, and from another standpoint of the revolutionary orthodoxy of the West, in its political form of the 19th century doctrines of liberalism and socialism, and its personal form of the worldwide popular romantic culture. Now, I'm not going to seek now at the end of the course to describe that tradition or its conceptions, but simply to emphasize one of its attributes. And the attribute is the idea that although we are shaped by the social and conceptual worlds that we build and inhabit, there is always more in us, in each of us individually, and in all of us collectively, the human race, than there is in them. They are infinite. We are infinite in relation to them, and they are finite in relation to us. We outreach them. And this is a particular conception. It's not a neutral conception. It's not a conception which is universally accepted in the world, and it is in contest with other views. And there is this interminable war of such conceptions. So I just want to say a word about the character of these conceptions, about their characteristics, of which this conception, to which I've just alluded, is one, but not the only one. It's the one that, in a sense, commands the agenda in the world. Because for the last 200 or 300 years, it has set the whole world on fire. And all the other conceptions in the world react to it or respond to it. First, these conceptions are like self-fulfilling prophecies. They tell us, believe us, and enact us, and if you believe us, you will make us true by enacting us. But to say that they're self-fulfilling prophecies is not to say that they can automatically redraw the world in their own image. The facts fight back. So, the self-fulfilling prophecies are only imperfectly capable of self-fulfillment. And the attempt to enact them provides some evidence in favor of them or against them. A second characteristic of these basic conceptions is that they all anchor an existential imperative. A view of how to live or how to organize society in a vision of reality or of humanity. So they have a normative or prescriptive aspect, and they have a factual aspect. You're all familiar with the distinction between the is and the ought, between the factual and the normative. And this distinction logically makes sense locally in local arguments, but it fails to make sense globally. The more global, the more inclusive our arguments are, the less it is the case that we can distinguish between the factual and the normative. A third characteristic of these prophetic conceptions is that they refuse to be cabined in any narrow part of experience. This is a characteristic of religion, but it's a characteristic generally of our most fundamental views. They invade every aspect of experience. We can't distinguish the private and the public or one department of experience from another. They demand to be fulfilled everywhere in every part of our action. So the category of religion is, in this respect, misleading, because the term religion, the word, was actually coined in the 18th century, in the middle period of the history of Protestantism, in a period in which religion was regarded, came to be increasingly regarded as something private. But the truth about these basic conceptions is that they're not private or public, they're about everything. They invade everything. They can't be segmented. That's the nature of these basic conceptions. Now, the fourth attribute, and the one that is, in a sense, the most daunting, is the following. We all have to commit our lives in one direction or another. Whether or not we formulate explicitly and self-reflectively our beliefs in justification of these commitments. So even if we have no such explicit beliefs, the way in which we live, what we do with our lives, will reveal our underlying assumptions. We can't escape this need for commitment. It's not something that we can choose to avoid. So these large conceptions of who we are and who we should or could become are about this commitment of our existence and of the organization of society in one direction or another. So in this sense, they're fateful. They regard what's most important, what we will do with our time. Now, it turns out that we can give reasons for preferring one conception to another. But these reasons are always incomplete and defective. And they seem to be completely disproportional to the weight of the commitment. So the commitment is fateful. It's the most important commitment we can make. And the grounds for making the commitment always seem to be inadequate to the weight of the commitment. It's not the same thing as saying that there are no reasons, that it's arbitrary. But just that the reasons or the grounds are contestable, uncertain, but the commitment is fateful and unavoidable. Now, it seems to me that this is not a characteristic of any argument of mine here, just a characteristic of our situation. And of the situation of these basic conceptions. And all of these particular enterprises in a field of thought are really instances of this general problem. So, our most ambitious intellectual and political enterprises now in the world don't live under the label of philosophy. Philosophy has been desiccated. It's become, to a large part, this thought police that no one wants. So the real philosophy or the real politics lives in these particular domains, like the domain that we pursued here. But then we face all of these problems. Problems that I've just recalled. So that's what I wanted to say, and now I'm open for your discussion and your questions and your comments in relation to the arguments of this course. Yes?
You say that legal thought is not a thing in itself, it's not necessary.
Not a thing in itself, with an eternal essence.
What about the other academic disciplines? History, chemistry, mathematics. Which of those three would you say?
Nothing. So let's take an example of physics, Newtonian physics, Newtonian mechanics. It's a structural science. It's ahistorical. And then there's this idea associated with the ascendancy of the model, of the example of Newtonian mechanics in physics, that the more historical a science is, the more sunk it is in historical contingency, the less fundamental it is. So biology is weak physics, and human history is sort of weak biology. Now then, starting in the second decade of the 20th century, after the initial emergence of relativity and quantum mechanics, we discovered that the universe has a history, and it's historical. And that none of the regularities of nature, or its basic constituents, as now described in the standard model of particle physics, could have existed in the earliest moments of the history of the universe. And that then raises the question of whether, even in our thinking about nature, we should think of structure as accessory to history. So, the way that intellectual life is stabilized in the university culture is by the naturalization of the marriage between method and subject matter. I just gave the example of physics. In thinking about society, the paramount example is economics. So economics, as now understood, is not the study of the economy. It's the study of a method. The method developed by the marginalist theoreticians at the end of the 19th century. And that's what happens. So that's the corruption of thought. So we think that there's an inherent connection between a method and a subject matter. Physics is ahistorical, biology is more historical, and so forth. And then there's this naturalization of the history of ideas. Well, all progress in thought depends on the disruption of such assumptions. And so the principle or the method that I tried to pursue here in the examination of legal analysis would apply to any department of thought, on my view. And this is something, going back to my critical comments about the academics. So I said the characteristic trajectory of an academic career is that very early on the academic assimilates a style of argument and analysis in his early 20s. In his period of formation, and then spends the rest of his life feeding material through this analytic and argumentative apparatus. It's the opposite of what should happen. So methods are a dime a dozen. The only thing that counts is vision, is substance. And a higher standard of intellectual ambition is that we pursue a substantive ambition wherever it takes us. And it requires us periodically to burn up the methods, to revise them, to throw them out. And we don't assume that there's any kind of natural connection between a substantive agenda and a methodological approach. That's the opposite of thought. That's not what thought is. Thought exists as like a storm. It's like the poet. You don't do what you set out to do. You do what you have to do. You're taken in a direction in which you did not want to go. And if it's not like that, it's not serious. It's frivolous. Then it's a kind of window dressing. But that's a higher standard of ambition, and it's the only standard of ambition that's worthy of the human life. Anything else is dishonorable and belittling. That's my view. I haven't argued for that view theoretically. I attempted simply to exemplify it in these arguments about legal analysis. Yes. Speak louder, please. Yes.
Which I kind of imply that
anything?
That democratic framework is correct. It's political institutional block that is called this transfer framework, you know, and that is incorrect. No, I mean, there wouldn't be a more authoritarian framework to like build this project on. I guess I'd say that, say, like, my understanding is that, like,
no, that's not what I think. So first, let's step back. Point. So now we're dealing with this. We're dealing with the problems of politics and of structural imagination. That's what your question is raising. The most common way to enter into a discussion of structural alternatives is from the bottom up. So you have an interest in particular problems, and then you discover that those problems can't be resolved within the limits of the established structure. So I would want to argue the following thesis, that none of the basic problems of the contemporary societies, including the rich North Atlantic industrial democracies, can be solved or even addressed within the limits of the social democratic settlement of the mid-20th century. So the way of providing public services that make people, that develop their capabilities, the relation of finance to the real economy, the extent to which the new knowledge-intensive form of production remains confined in an isolated vanguard or is widely disseminated in the economy, the practical basis of social solidarity when money transfers organized by the state turn out to be an insufficient basis of social solidarity, or in politics, the degree to which structural change depends on crisis. None of these problems that require institutional innovation in the form of economic and political life can be solved within the limits of the social democratic compromise. So the whole nature of that mid-20th century social compact was that the forces that challenged the established organization of power and production retreated from the challenge, and in return, the state was allowed to acquire the power to regulate the economy, to manage it countercyclically, and to attenuate inequality through compensatory and retrospective redistribution by tax and transfer. That's not good enough. We can't, within the limits of that retreat, we can't solve any problem. That's one set of claims. So you could start as a politician, as a practical thinker, as an activist, as a policymaker, from the bottom up, and come to a realization that you can't solve anything within that prison, and that you need to acquire the power to innovate in the institutional range. So that's one way. Or you could come from the top down, and you could rebel against the present mentality of the progressives, which combines a supposed egalitarian commitment with an institutional conservatism or agnosticism. So they accept the present structure of society. They claim to be egalitarians, but they combine this egalitarian profession of faith with an institutional surrender. And the combination then results in the pragmatic residue, which is what do they then in fact do? What they do is they devote themselves to these two ameliorative practices of compensatory redistribution by tax and transfer, and of the idealization of law in the language of impersonal policy and principle. And they invent intellectual projects like the theories of justice or the method of reasoned elaboration that give a kind of pseudo-philosophical support to these ameliorative practices. So that wasn't what the progressive project was before in the 19th century. The liberals and the socialists of the 19th century, they had a higher ideal. Their ideal was not simply to equalize, to increase residual equality in society. Their ideal was a greater life for the ordinary man and woman. And the rebellion against extreme inequality is subsidiary to that larger goal. And their instrument was the institutional reconstruction of society. But we can't believe, as they did, in a dogmatic institutional formula. And this then comes to your comment. So we can't bring ourselves to believe that there is any definitive blueprint, such as the liberals or the socialists of the 19th century proposed, that we can trust as definitive. So we need, how are we to solve this problem? That we need structural change, but we are unwilling to succumb to structural dogmatism. So we need institutions that have among their attributes that they lend themselves to revision in the light of experience, that they have the attribute of corrigibility, so that we can develop the way along the way. And that's part of our circumstance, of how we can be, how we can take a structural direction without being dogmatists as they were. This whole approach to legal analysis that I've advocated has that belief as part of its background. Yes, do you want to follow up?
I do.
No, yes. Yes.
He wants to create this egalitarian society. If I, as a student here, but I, as a member of that population, want to like create some kind of radical change, I don't have the power necessary to do so in this framework. Then, like, what is my project? What do I actually do? Because it seems to depend on people in these kinds of future to want to realize that egalitarian ideals. You need to, in other words, like, look at the anomalous.
Yes.
Part and parcel of this new social democratic project, how do you then reflect that in the ground that people have the power to really gain or legislate?
Well, I'm not sure I understand. What is the particular problem? What's the focus of the problem then? What is missing from our understanding?
I think the focus of the problem is, I think, yes, it's true that many believe there's a structural problem.
Yes.
And I can understand the position that structural solution, I think in one way you say like it's not necessary to change or it's not feasible, that you just keep it like a problem within the structural framework. So if you move to capitalism and socialism, the same problems will occur. And that structural solution is not sufficient to really build
yes.
at the
yes.
level. How do you still but that structural problem, if you think that within
No, but you don't, but so there are two things. So there are two contrasts that are somehow mixed together and we have to disentangle to achieve greater intellectual clarity. So first, there's the way of thinking about structure in relation to the problem that I call the systemic illusion. So the idea of the Marxists, but more widely, the dominant idea in classical social theory was that the basic regimes are indivisible systems, right? So either you replace a whole system, capitalism by socialism, for example, or you are engaged in the reformist management of the system. Now, I think that idea is false. There aren't these indivisible systems. This is one of the illusions of classical social theory. And it makes us believe that gradualism is associated with the renunciation of structural ambition, and structural ambition is associated with the idea of instantaneous systemic change. Instantaneous systemic change doesn't exist. It's a limiting case, it's a fantasy. So structural change, when it exists in history, is fragmentary. But it can nevertheless be radical if it persists cumulatively in a particular direction. So that's one element in the debate. That's, as it were, the empirical element. And we have to take a position with respect to that. Now, there's a second element, which is the normative element, which is the understanding of the goal. Huh? What's the goal? So for the progressives and late liberals of the late 20th century, the early 21st century, the goal is to humanize society, is to make things less unequal. But that was never the goal of the progressives. Their goal was not to humanize society. Their goal was to divinize humanity. It was to increase our share in the attributes that we ascribe to the divine, to make us bigger, a shared bigness. So that the ordinary man and woman could have a bigger life, with wider scope, with greater intensity, with larger capabilities. And the struggle against inequality was entirely subsidiary to that larger objective. So when we come to disbelieve in that idea, then we settle for something less. So and then it's just a distribution of material resources. It's an increase in equality. Rousseau says something in his writings. They couldn't become men, therefore they decided to become rich. It's clear that the objective of equalization viewed in that way is a substitute for something larger. So I think that the beginning of a different way of thinking lies in the combination of those two sets of ideas, the empirical ideas and the normative ideas. Now, that's just very general, of course, but then you have to engage in the details of your historical circumstance, right? And it's very different being a theoretician and being an agent. So Goethe made this remark that the contemplative position is always ironic and fatalistic. It's when you start to act practically or intellectually that you discover transformative opportunity, because then you see that the world is full of contradiction. And people think mistakenly that they need to be hopeful in order to act. It's the opposite. It's action that generates hope. You don't need to be hopeful to act. You can act for any reason. because you're indignant, because you're unresigned. But if you act intellectually or practically, you become hopeful, because action demonstrates the contradictory character of the world. And then you need ideas.
So
yes.
I was thinking about the resistance to your line of thinking, and it's not with your characterization of the situation. I think most people would agree. And you're saying that when it comes to hope, you think a lot of people lack that hope. But I think it comes back to taking that transformative action, and that most people are afraid to expose themselves to the risk of taking or making those changes.
Risk. So what kind of risk do you have in mind? You mean personal risk?
Personal risk. So,
yeah.
You know, let's say you're in a committee or on a board and you want to make a change.
Yes.
And then the board turns on you.
Yeah. Yes, this is very interesting, right? Because all transformative action and insight in the world and everything that's higher in our experience, including personal love, depends on an acceptance of vulnerability. So we can't do anything in the world without throwing down our shields in some way. So if we are immunizing ourselves, if we're blockading ourselves, then there's this coat of armor around us and becomes a mummy, and inside we begin to die, right? So, and this is the opposite of what we should want. So this is what happens to us. Huh? We get older and we form this mummy, the rigidified form of the self, which is the character, and then we begin to die in little pieces. And our goal should be to die only once. But then there's a price, and the price is accepting a higher degree of vulnerability. Now, I think that this is not simply a problem of personal strategies. In some respects, it's responsive to institutional design. So if we enhance the endowments that people have, their basic capabilities and protections, while throwing all of social life open to greater experimental openness, we make it possible for them to tolerate more risk. And this is what should be desired. It's like what I mentioned in relation to the idea of the endowments. The parent says to the child, "I love you unconditionally. Now go out and raise a storm in the world." So that the existence of this haven of basic security allows us then to risk, and then we achieve the supreme good. The supreme good is life, more life. And it has a price. Vitality has a price. The price of vitality is vulnerability. Without vulnerability, there is no vitality. And this is a fundamental principle, and it's related to something very deep, which people have trouble understanding, which in the hierarchy of the virtues, courage is not the highest virtue compared to other virtues like hope or love, but courage is the enabling virtue, because without courage, all the other virtues are rendered sterile, and therefore, courage is the first virtue of the citizen, of the agent, and of the thinker. Without courage, there's nothing. And courage, especially in as manifest in the willingness to accept a higher level of vulnerability. Yes.
I have two questions.
Yes.
First is that I'm trying to grapple with the four different structural alternatives you you discussed, of course, two of them that I sort of identify as sort of lower order alternatives, which are like the deviant sort of doctrinal tools, relational contract and disaggregated property, and two of the more higher order alternatives.
Yes.
That are sort of the social inheritance or empowerment and the structuralizing structure. And I'm trying to understand, I sort of was following until we got to the higher order alternatives, because I thought to myself, okay, so the proposal that you're suggesting is to look at different fields of the law, find the deviant doctrine, and use that for
Correct.
Structural change. What is...
But let me clarify something
sure.
here again. So in that part of the argument, I wasn't describing alternative structural trajectories. That is something I believe in and something I propose and do and so forth. I was describing, as it were, the toolbox that contemporary law and legal thought provides us with if we are interested in formulating such structural alternatives. Huh? So, for example, take the project of disseminating the new advanced form of production. So the knowledge-intensive, experimental, so-called post-Fordist economy, which now exists only in these isolated vanguards from which most of the labor force remains excluded. So then the question arises, how could we have this advanced form of production in a form that would be widely disseminated within the economy and therefore socially inclusive? It requires a series of educational and institutional initiatives. For example, we would have to organize a regime of cooperative competition among advanced small and medium-sized firms. And then the tools of relational contract and disaggregated property would become useful. So in a more complete argument, there'd be these steps. And after the step of dealing with the toolbox, you would go to the next step of formulating the proposal of alternative structural trajectories. And one focal point would be a question like this one of organizing the socially inclusive form of the new economy. But I couldn't do that because it's this problem, this absurd problem, right? There's 11 classes and this division of things. So I'm teaching this another course called Progressive Alternatives, and another one about philosophy or another one about economy. But from my standpoint, they're all the same ideas. But we can't organize things this way, right? Because then we can't be together for 22 hours. We have to be together for hundreds of hours, and no one has patience for that. So this is the crucial requirement of thought, patience. But it's related to that. So it's just a signal, right? And that's all we can do.
Okay, I think I understand. So essentially, the first two are sort of the toolbox. And
the others are also part of the toolbox, but at a higher level, right? Because they describe the idea of plasticity-enabling endowments and the idea of a structure-revising structure. They're meta-ideas. They describe common characteristics of a set of legal innovations that could serve a wide range of transformative projects, right? So the point is, we need structural change. We can't enshrine or entrench one particular structural blueprint unlike the liberals and socialists of the 19th century. We need these projects, these arrangements that among their attributes have the attributes of lending themselves to correction. So they don't depend on crisis to make change possible. Yes?
I'm curious about the role of religion and other privately held beliefs that are difficult to articulate in public language in deliberative democracy and what you think about that.
No, say that again?
So if you have, you said that religion and other beliefs that are out of proportion with the reasons why we both put in religion that they're important to us, how do you reconcile that with the deliberative democratic process?
No, I didn't say you can't convey reasons. I said that the reasons are never conclusive. So what I said is that all of our transformative action in the world, all of our action, the way our decisions about committing our lives and our societies in one direction or another, imply a view of who we are. And these view are these prophecies. They have this ineradicable pragmatic element that they're not just descriptive accounts. They're proposals. So they tell us, act as if I were true, and you'll make me true. As I said, the facts fight back because they may be made more true or less true. And it's not as if we don't have reasons for preferring some to the other. We do have reasons. But it's not like a demonstration in geometry. So the reasons aren't conclusive. The reasons are imperfect. And the proposals remain incontestable. The proposals remain contestable. But we have to wager our lives in the meantime. It's not as if we could wait for the debate to be resolved. So you have one life. How are you going to live it? And how are you going to organize your society? And you have reasons. And there are reasons. But the reasons are imperfect. That's how it is. And the more global our arguments are, the more they have this character. So in this respect, I don't see this as a problem in my arguments. I see this as a characteristic of our situation. And which we don't improve by somehow hiding from it. And so all of these particular interventions in special areas of our experience are entangled in this, in this relative darkness. So it's not as if reason were impotent, but we do nothing for ourselves if we claim for our powers of reason more than they are. That's the kind of argument that I'm making. And to me, it's just extraordinary and heartening how much we can see and argue, despite this limitation, and that's just a basic feature of hope. You know, somewhere in the world as will and representation, Schopenhauer makes this remark about that. The difference between a talented person and a genius, so it says. A talented person is a marksman who hits a target that others cannot hit. A genius is a marksman who hits a target that others cannot see. And this is the character of genius. Genius, the genius is not someone who thinks more cleverly than other people. Genius is about vision. This is what we all want for ourselves, that we could have a wider vision, that we could see more deeply, and that we could organize ourselves, arrange our minds so that we could have this vision and so that it could free us. And in a way, it's the central theme of all of our inquiries here. I'm very grateful to you for your boundless patience. For me, it's been a wonderful experience. Thank you very much.
Graduating because it's on the 15th, it's in the next.
How did you do the world?
Pick out a sign with that, you know, you get three tries and they only take the highest score. Yeah, so it's number two.
Yeah, my thought is, I'm gonna be kind of,
what am I doing to go to the summer?
Pretty much part-time.
I work for a time also.
And he's super Marxist, like the way he places himself into history is like such a Hegelian and like proper.
The first, like,
So it's also about having more language.
And it shows you 5 points.
See you in class.
See you. Thank you.
think that's good and that's wrong. You're right. Thank you. Don't need any feedback.
But he.
But he's super effective in our team. I just sent him the other day. I had an issue with my paper at midnight, and I was like, I need to pass this over. And I wrote him at midnight, and he answered at midnight, plus 1 minute. Like yes, come on.
Yeah, but he actually, I sent my paper, but actually, I didn't have like any particular issue. I just thought this is my draft. I think it's time to have a feedback. I can just help him get it. Oh, I received your paper. It's here. It was printed on his table, but I will read it tonight. It was like last night. Bye.
Y'all have these photos.
Hi.
Que engraçado que a gente sai,
mano. Não, chega só falando que tem que ter paciência, porque não tem muita paciência.
Ele?
É. Já entregou?
É, eu vou entregar essa semana.
Aí é só orientador?
É. Não, é só aí que a Marina. Eu mandei pra vários professores. Que é a forma de receber feedback de várias pessoas. E aí depois que acabar as provas, eu vou sentar e pegar o feedback dos professores. Não, e tentar melhorar várias coisas que eu ainda quero. Tentar publicar. Tentar deixar no formato de publicação.
Mas já vai pra dentro, já se entrega assim ou você entrega depois?
Essa versão agora já vai pro meu campo. Porque aí depois eu vou tentar trabalhar numa versão de futuro.
Tá, legal. Eu dar uma olhada depois.
Mas se você quiser, eu te mando. Quando eu recebi, quando a versão que eu submetei agora, eu te mando.
Tá bom.
Me manda um e-mail.
Eu mando.
Aí eu, só pra eu gravar o seu e-mail, aí eu falo. É bom que você também me dá.
É. Agora que eu quero ler, tem que aproveitar. Porque eu sou bom para fazer as coisas aqui, né, fora dos cursos.
É, exato. Que você não faz prova.
Prova não. Mas outro curso que eu fiz, ele deu muito material, né? Eu fiz ler.
Aí você fica até quando?
É, 30 de julho.
Ah.
Você já vai?
Já? Não, tem as provas e tem depois a formatura, vou no dia 26 de maio.
Não.
Quando você tiver de bobeira, dá um toque, uma cerveja. Só não essa semana que vai ser quinta. E na outra tem prova. Mas depois eu tô livre.
Ah,
livre, 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 livre. Assim, né?
É, vou ver também se eu venho aqui uns dias para a biblioteca.
É, mas tem que fazer. Tenta aproveitar para poder você baixar, né?
Ah, bom, isso eu já baixei
muito. Muito livro online. Eu ainda tenho que fazer isso.
Eu começo e não acabo, né? É. Aí eu falo, não, tem que escrever alguma coisa.
Não, eu tenho que fazer isso.
Não, só
eu acho que vou passar uns 2 dias para mim, eu só baixando.
Ah, mas dá muita coisa, o que tem na internet dá pra fazer no seu, né?
Dá. Eu consegui acessar.
Você acha que fica válido por um tempo depois do YouTube, não?
Cara, eu não sei, com precaução.
É, eu... depois que você voltar, é. Você não vai ter.
E pra ter acesso, principalmente alguns papers de alguns revistas, é muito ruim você achar, e você acha muito fácil. O bom da ferramenta de rápido é que você acha fácil e rápido.
O que tem online é ótimo, né? Meu orientador só pediu umas coisas tão difíceis que nem aqui tem, é fazer. É. Se não tem aqui, não tem lugar nenhum. Né?
Mas mesmo... fala com algum bibliotecário, eles ajudam muito a achar.
É, não, mas isso daí era uma coisa também que era um negócio interno, que era interno de um negócio de Florença. Quer dizer, não sei por não tem isso.
Deixa eu ver, eu tenho uma aula aqui nessa semana.
Caraca.
Vamos lá, tchau, tchau.
Tchau.
Assistem as quatro aulas toda semana?
Eu assisto. Eu veio, eu assisti um. Uma semana eu assisti as quatro.
É, pelo menos as quatro, mas assisti duas semanas de fevereiro e duas semanas agora.
Agora, quando
tem um pouco de tempo. Mas aí eu me
internalizo.
Cada aula te dá uma perspectiva, né? Essa aula é de direito. Agora, a aula amanhã é de economia, né? E aí
as pessoas ficam em pontos constantes justamente para se limitar, mesmo diante de um problema, ela reforça os constantes. É exatamente o que ele fala. Você reforça os constantes como um certo que você não sofre. Como se o problema das pessoas são meio frouxas, para que você não frouxe, então você tem que apertar o barco. Quando na verdade você está se limitando mais. Né?
É mais fácil você ficar dentro do que já se comunica, né? Então você escolhe um lado, mas assim, quanto mais simples que uma pessoa, vai escolher um lado, ela está defendendo aquilo. Quanto mais avançado, ela vai conseguir olhar com as perspectivas e pensar de uma forma mais completa. Ele falou, esse é o mais talentoso. O gênio é ele, que ele consegue pensar como sair desse embrólio todo e já dar saída para a gente tirar uma coisa. Imaginar que, olha, eu estou ensinando, quando vocês deixarem de ser bom na construção agora, vocês vão estar pensando assim, entendeu?
É, isso é difícil para mim explicar.
Agora, com ele, é como você pega as pessoas céticas, é você tentando convencer. Aí ele fala, não, mas isso é mudança impossível. Isso é estrutural demais. Isso vai demorar muito. Como se isso fosse desculpa. Tá? Isso é o que mais me chateia.
É, mas é difícil, lógico que ele funciona, ele põe para a sua vida, ele rindo, ele vai para a sala, uma festa, vai para a vida de vida, sabe? Deixando umas coisas assim, porque o pessoal vai deixar de lado, e vai ficar com a vida, né? Porque é uma mudança tão profunda.
Deus serve para todo mundo.
cambiando las personas, no es. Y creo que estamos.